Okay, I believe we are live. Hello, everybody. As you can see by my lovely nameplate, my name is Jada Adams, and we're here with Rosanna Tufts, who is a dear friend, and she is going to share her love for silent movies with us.
Hi. Thanks so
Hi.
much for having me. This is, I've never done a show quite like this before
Oh, yeah?
because I mean there it's kind of an obscure subject,
Yeah, yeah.
but I think but since yeah, I mean I'm supposed to start the show by taking the influence that I'm supposed to be under,
Ah,
right?
yes.
Yeah, I'm supposed to do that. Right. Okay. So, here's my influence.
Ah,
It's
okay.
brownies,
Brownies.
which were made by my new son-in-law with Rick Simpson oil.
Nice.
So
Delicious.
I'm going to have a little piece of this.
Okay.
Om nom.
Nom nom indeed.
And we'll get going. I will
All right.
probably sleep very well tonight.
All righty.
So, as I'm sure your fans are aware, one of the hallmarks of being autistic is to have obsessive and often unusual interests. I have many, but and silent movies was one of my earliest. So, word of advice to your viewers, as the theme indicates, this is going to be a very visual episode. So don't just listen to it while you're doing other things. Sit down and actually watch it because you are in for a treat
I'm so
of a
excited.
lost art. So, why silent movies? How did I get into this? When I was a little girl, usually right around Easter, I would see old movies on TV that were set in biblical times, movies like the Ten Commandments, The Robe, Ben-Hur. You might recognize some of these.
Oh,
These
yeah.
were not silent movies, however. They were filmed in the 1950s. But they were all epics with terrific production values that, to my young mind, came across like documentaries,
Yeah.
which got me to thinking, wait, what? Did movie cameras even exist 2,000 years ago? Of course, they didn't. But another old movie I saw on TV was called The Perils of Pauline, about one of the earliest action adventure movie stars, a lady named Pearl White.
What? Oh.
That was filmed in 1947, but it was set in the 19 teens, early days of film.
Okay.
So that got me even more confused. And eventually, I got so puzzled that one day I decided I needed to go to the town library and check out a book on film history so I could get the straight story on this. I was 11 and I went to the town library, not the school library. Got there on my bike. Now, 11 is the perfect age to cultivate an encyclopedic knowledge of something because that's when you've become proficient enough in reading that you can start reading to learn. So that's also about the point when you should know enough about the Dewey Decimal System that you're able to find anything in a library. Now, mind you, when I turned 11, it was the year 1970. No internet yet, no Google, no YouTube. You search through card catalogs to find stuff.
It's
Prehistoric
microfiche
Googling.
was in the 80s, wasn't it?
Yes,
So
microfiche
microfiche
was
hadn't
around
even,
too.
yeah. Oh,
Microfiche was around
was
too at
around.
that
Okay.
point, but that's normally the card catalogs were your first line of inquiry.
Yeah.
So I did find a book. I brought it home and started reading about the invention of movies and the first 35 years of their existence, from 1893 to the late 1920s. And the pictures in this and other books like it were absolutely fascinating to me. Like this one from a
Wow.
very early version of Peter Pan.
Oh, wow.
Or this famous, very famous actor from that time period, Charlie Chaplin as the Little Tramp.
Yeah.
And prettiest of them all, Mary Pickford,
oh,
with her
wow.
golden ringlets, and the first movie star to get be awarded a $1 billion contract.
Wow.
She did a lot of amazing things and did them all before women had the right to vote. So I'm thinking, gods, I wish I could actually see things like this. Lucky me. A year later, the local PBS station in Boston started running a weekly series of films, some of the films that have survived from that time period and been preserved or restored. Remember, Turner Classic Movies did not exist yet. In fact, cable didn't exist yet. So this was a rare treat for aficionados. But because I had the chance to watch these, combined with my parallel fascination for ballet, is why I can understand body language and read facial expressions despite being autistic. You know how that's usually a big problem for autists?
Yeah.
Well, this is an art form where so much has to be conveyed without spoken dialogue.
And everything has to be so overly expressive. So, yeah.
Not necessarily. I'm going to show you some very subtle examples that show you everything without overdoing it. We'll get to that.
Sweet.
However, if I dared talk about this openly, in the 1970s, nobody knew anything about autism except mental health professionals.
Yeah.
But bullies, they can spot an autist faster than any therapist.
Yep.
And I'd already been a social pariah for 6 years at that point. Being so passionate about such an old-fashioned thing that didn't even exist anymore.
Yeah.
If the other kids thought I was weird before, this made them think I was downright insane. And so silent movies kind of had to become a guilty pleasure. Okay, yes, I'll admit, it was a primitive technology. Those early cameras were nothing more than boxes, no electricity running to them, and you had to crank them by hand.
Yeah.
One of the tricks the early cameramen used to keep a consistent speed of the film running through the camera was to sing the anvil chorus to themselves. Dum, 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 da dum, da dum, da dum, da dum, dum.
Oh, wow.
Yes, a little behind the scenes tip. Sound recording in the late Victorian era and well into the 1920s consisted of talking, singing, or playing into a big bell horn with a needle at the other end that would etch the vibrations onto a spinning disc, completely acoustic, using electricity to record sound through microphones. Wasn't possible until 1924. And it took a few more years after that for to work out how to capture sound on film. Excuse me, my computer's about to die. I'm plugging it in.
All good.
Now, if you've ever seen the musical Singing in the Rain, that's a comedy about the transition from silent movies to what they call talkies.
Talkies, yeah.
The late 1920s. And how difficult it was to figure out where to put the microphones.
Oof.
And then there was the problem of how do you retrofit existing theaters with actual speaker systems to play the recorded sound?
Yeah.
All that was a transition period that took several years before it to become standard. But Well, before anybody was thinking about any of that, the early filmmakers got quite innovative in working around the limitations of what a hand-cranked movie camera could do. Now I'm going to go to share screen. There. All right.
There we go.
Have you heard of a zoetrope? This is a Victorian toy. It's a spinning cylinder with little slits in the side. You would take a little strip of paper that had little drawings evenly spaced along it and put this into the cylinder. And then when you spin the cylinder and look through the slits, drawings create movement. So it was early animation.
Yeah, you may want to turn the sound on those down. It was hard to hear your voice over that.
Okay, sure. I will attempt to do so the next time I do it. Okay. So, yeah. So it's if the drawings would create the illusion of movement.
Yeah.
So it was early animation. Trouble was you could only get about 1 second of a piece of action that repeated over and over and over. If only you could get an effect that lasts longer. How many inventions have we come up with that started with somebody asking, if you could only fill in the blank? Now, for that, you would need photography, which became widespread during and after the American Civil War. What if, instead of photographing onto big single plates and then developing them in a dark room, you could photo a series of smaller frames passing quickly in front of a lens that, as it opens and closes, equally quickly. That's basically what a movie camera is. That's what it's doing. Thomas Edison here and the Lumiere brothers in France figured this one out, making little vignette films. At first, they only lasted 1 minute, but that was still a big advance over the 1 second of the zoetrope. And to play them, you would go to these little parlors called Nickelodeons. Most people think of Nickelodeon as the as the TV channel, but these were the original Nickelodeons. And what you would do is you put a little nickel into the slot of a machine, and then you could watch a 1 minute film. This was Annabella. Annabella was a vaudeville performer, and she was famous for doing veil dances. Only one person at a time could watch these through the little machine.
Yeah.
So the next frontier after that was, how could you get more people seeing one film and make more money that way?
Because of course.
Yes. Enter the film projector, which could splash the images from the little film frames onto a big screen. How powerful was this? Well, when audiences saw a film like this, and they panicked, thinking the train was about to run them over.
Wow.
Well, that's when people started getting the idea that this new medium could have a really...
We're setting ourselves up for a showdown at the 11th...
Stop. We're setting... That was something. Somebody else. Fair and balanced. Suddenly busted in there. So they started getting the idea that this new medium could have a really emotional impact, but they still didn't even realize what it was. How can they do this? How can they use this most effectively?
Mm-hmm.
So when it came to using film to tell a story, the French at first were way ahead of us.
Oh, yeah.
Recognize this one?
Yeah.
Trip to the Moon.
Yep. Oh, classic.
State-of-the-art special effects.
Yeah, I'm just how fantastic.
In 1902.
Yeah, wow.
So that was that was by the Lumiere brothers, and they were also pioneers of special effects. Now, the first American story movie to become hugely popular, I mean, nationwide, not just in little pockets, was in, you guessed it, that uniquely American genre, the Western.
Ah.
Stop share. Wait a minute. Ah, get me back to, share, trying to find the right share here.
All good.
Is that it? Okay. Get me back to here. I know what I need to do. There we go. Okay. The Great Train Robbery. Is also.
Yeah, yeah.
It's a static camera at this point. Help, help! The train's being robbed! Get down. Stop! There we go. Okay, The Great Train Robbery from 1903. Motion pictures had been around in some form for about 10 years already, but the films were still quite short, only about 10 to 15 minutes. One camera reel could hold one film. You could tell a complete story in that time, but could a film with no speech hold an audience attention for longer time, as if they were watching a play in a theater? It took another 10 years, but it was the Italians who got to this one first. They pioneered the feature-length film and did it in epic fashion with massive sets and crowd scenes that you couldn't do this in a theater.
Wow. Wow, that is a hell of a set.
Yeah.
Oh, hold on. Oh, wow.
What's inside the oven? We right. don't know.
Or you don't want to know.
Yeah, but you could see from this that this was something that burst beyond the confines of the stage. And it proved that film was its own thing. It was its own medium and not the poor relation of the theater.
Yeah.
It could take you to places you could only dream of. Ah, but would American producers ever be that daring, given the astronomical costs of making such a feature-length film? Director D.W. Griffith blew through the company budget to do it.
Oh my God.
But he was the first one out of the gate. He made a biblical epic of his own based on the Book of Judith. So there was no turning back after that. World War I pretty much destroyed the European film industry. I mean, you could see that they were making leaps and bounds and that suddenly it all just completely, you couldn't do it anymore.
Yeah.
So that destroyed their industry for about half a decade while World War I was going on. So that meant the United States became the center of the film world, especially in the new boom town of Hollywood. Now, you might have noticed something kind of odd about these early films, how over the top the acting was, as if trying to overcompensate for the lack of dialogue, and how the camera tended to sit back away from the actors as if they were photographing a stage play. I mentioned the static camera from earlier.
Yeah.
So this is probably the biggest reason why people think silent movies are so laughable, because they've only ever seen bad acting.
Yeah.
Like William Shatner on steroids. Okay. Share again. Share and share alike. Got things going on top of my... How do I get this to come back up front? Here we go. Yeah, so you can see that how that's it's like speed the camera being static like that, you can see the actors' bodies, but you can't really see their faces except for that one central guy in the middle.
Yeah,
D.W. Griffith was the director most responsible for realizing you didn't need to do that. You didn't need to lock down the camera like that. You didn't need to be so melodramatic and histrionic with your acting.
Mm-hmm.
He pioneered the close-up, soft focus lenses, and indirect lighting.
Mm.
And that is what made it possible for film acting to be a lot more subtle, small expressions.
Mm-hmm.
You could really get into the interior state of a character's mind. See the difference?
Yeah.
Big difference.
Oh, yeah.
Big difference. So by the late teens, that was Broken Blossoms from 1919, and also directed by D.W. Griffith. And by the late teens, American film had reached a level of high art. And you notice how silent movies were never really silent. They were always accompanied by music. Mm-hmm. At the very least, a piano.
Mm-hmm.
In the bigger cities, they could have full orchestras or a big, mighty Wurlitzer organ. If you ever go to Radio City Music Hall, they still have theirs. And you can listen to theirs before they start the show. So, although without spoken dialogue, comedy especially relied heavily on sight gags. Hey, get back there. Not yet. Here we go. See what they did there?
Yeah.
The opening scene faked you out.
Yeah.
The boy's about to be hanged to death.
Yep.
When he's really just saying goodbye at the train station. So this is Safety Last.
Mm-hmm.
And it stars Harold Lloyd, who was famous for a character where he was wearing glasses all the time. And it's my pick as the best film, a best feature film to introduce someone to silent films if they've never seen one. The story still holds up. It's about a country boy trying to make it in the big city. He goes to work in a multi-story department store and tries to impress the boss by orchestrating a publicity stunt. He hires a friend of his to scale the outside of the building as a human fly.
Mm.
But it turns out the friend is in trouble with the law. A cop is chasing him, and poor Harold has to climb the building himself. So if you want a combination of laughs and suspense, this is your best bet. With all the obstacles that get thrown at him on his way up the building. Right spot here. There we go.
I think that would be my reaction too.
Yes. You can see how tall the building is.
Yeah. If my fingers hurt watching this. God. Oh no.
Okay, he really was that high up. However, there was a platform with a mattress just below camera range.
My gosh.
Fun fact, he did those stunts with a prosthetic glove.
Interesting.
Yeah, an on-set accident on one of his earlier films blew off two of the fingers of his left hand.
Wow.
So he's a disability icon too.
Yeah, wow.
So, yeah, we've got some more clips I'd like to show here. Charlie Chaplin, I showed you a picture of him earlier. I'm going to show you a scene now of him as the little tramp. Now, one reason why Charlie Chaplin was such an icon and became one so early is because he happened to be coming along at the right time when we've got a huge influx of immigrants to this country. And people really gravitated toward him because he expressed the immigrant experience as someone who had to take various odd jobs and try to make his way and made no bones about thumbing his nose at authority, but was always very gracious and polite to the ladies. Okay.
move on.
He's not overdoing it.
Yeah.
He doesn't have to. He's still getting the point across.
Yeah.
Now, speaking of immigrants, silent movies were also a boon, a real help to the immigrant community, because they were coming here not with no knowledge of English, most of them, but they could understand the language of silent movies, pantomime, very well. And by reading the title cards that were used very sparingly, they could sort of piece together a knowledge of English. So it was very helpful to them in that way. So
that's really cool.
Yeah, speaking of subtlety, being able to convey everything while trying to hide it, which is what all great actors do.
Yeah.
Lillian Gish, who we saw earlier in Broken Blossoms, I'm going to show you a little bit of her in The Scarlet Letter, which is, this version of The Scarlet Letter is far and away the best version of it that's ever been filmed. And she's on the scaffold and being exhorted to reveal the name of her lover and the father of her baby.
Yeah.
That's the preacher, Dimmesdale. Get me out of there.
Don't.
Yeah, but she's hardly doing anything at all. Very little. And yet she, because the looks that she is giving are for his eyes only.
Yeah.
Not for the crowd.
Yep.
See how it works? So she became the master of underplaying. So when she had the chance to actually really bring on the intensity, it feels earned, if that makes sense.
Yeah, it does. It does.
Yeah. So this is going to be a scene from Orphans of the Storm, in which her real life sister is also one of the stars. They play two sisters, and one of whom is blind. And they arrive in Paris looking for a doctor who could help the blind sister. But it's right as the French Revolution is breaking out. They get separated in the mob, and at Lillian Gish at this point has not seen her sister in months, who in turn has fallen in with a troop of beggars and thieves. So another actress who became a master of understatement, Greta Garbo, known as the Swedish Sphinx. And she had such a sultry look that she didn't really need to do a whole heck of a lot in order to get the point across and beguile any man who fell under her spell. Okay, where are you? Now, is that smoking or what?
Right?
Not showing anything,
mm-hmm.
anything lewd, but you know what's going on. And now I want to show you someone who is so understated, he became known as the Great Stone Face, Buster Keaton. He had his shtick was that he had a really poker face. He was very expressive and physical from the neck down. But his face is like someone who is trying to keep it together and not panic, despite all of the crazy things going on around him. He was another one who did all of his own stunts.
Yeah.
And he usually likes to have himself photographed in full body shots so that you could see that it was really him and there was no jump cutting and
yeah.
that it was real. He was really doing it.
Yeah.
Someone with a more expressive face who had deaf parents, although he himself could hear just fine. But he was known for having a deaf face, meaning that deaf people could understand his expressions very clearly. I speak, of course, of the man known as the man of a thousand faces, Lon Chaney.
Lon Chaney Jr.
Senior.
Oh, my God.
Yes, you may have, maybe if you're a horror fan, you may be familiar with Lon Chaney Jr., who was the original Wolfman. His father, had a much bigger reputation for great character actor, did all of his own makeup. It took him 3 hours to get into character as Quasimodo The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Trigger warning. They're just leaving me. And the crowd's moved on.
Yep.
Well, most of them. First, he thinks he's going to hurt him, too. And then he realizes, oh, she's going to help. Now, I showed you a picture of Mary Pickford a little bit earlier. She was the first true movie star and the first to actually get $1 million contract ahead of Charlie Chaplin. And they were the two biggest stars in the world at that point. But she beat him to it. She was famous for playing little girl characters much younger than herself. Went back to an earlier place. You can also see how large her head was relative to her body.
Yeah.
She had this broad face, a big canvas for expressions to play across.
Yeah.
And people adored her. I mean, the combination of that face and those curls, she was innocence personified, but the gal also had range. Guess which one is Mary?
The one on the left?
They both are.
Oh, wow.
They filmed this in double exposure.
Oh, neat.
No makeup as the servant girl. Now, Mary Pickford was married to Douglas Fairbanks Sr., who was the first swashbuckling action star. The original Mark of Zorro. Showing him the reflection of the Z he has already marked him with. So Mary Pickford and Douglas Fairbanks, they were together Hollywood's first power couple. So, I mean, nobody in at least the Americas had never seen anything like it. And I'd like to end with a couple of German films that
Metropolis, yes.
Metropolis is one silent film that a lot of people have seen because of Giorgio Moroder. Created a new soundtrack for it.
Yeah, yeah.
And it too has a lot of really bad acting, but then again, it also has really eerie scenes, like the introduction of the robots. Everybody loves this. It's creepy. Notice the reverse pentagram behind the robot.
Yeah. I guess the supposition that making a robot is somehow satanic.
It's diabolical. So the last film I wanted to, a film clip I want to show you is called The Last Laugh. And it's a German film that shows what they called the unchained camera, and also showed how the Germans could really were innovators in lighting as well. Here, the hotel doorman has lost his job, and he gets really drunk, and he has a dream of himself getting his job back.
Nice approximation of being inebriated.
Yep. I figured with a show called Under the Influence, I had to show this.
Yeah. Yeah, the lighting is very dramatic.
Yes. The Germans were the masters of this. This is a, it's time period of the Weimar Republic.
Ah, okay.
Before the rise of Hitler. So they had about a 10-year period after World War I where they were very innovative.
Wow, and superimposed fan blades?
Yes.
Okay.
The dream sequence.
Yeah.
So I mean, you see what I mean by the unchained camera?
Yeah.
It's like that kind of filmmaking was pretty much silent films at their peak.
Yeah.
And then it was gone.
Yeah.
Because trying to bring in the sound technology, they had to lock the camera down again.
Yeah.
And it took a long time it took a couple of years. About half a decade before they started feeling comfortable about moving the camera around again.
Yeah. But I mean, that's 100 years ago.
Yes. And 100 years ago, they were doing this.
And we're showing YouTube clips of it.
Yes.
Which
is great because now it's a lot easier to find them than they were back when I was a kid.
Yeah, you
can find a lot of them on YouTube now, and more are being found and discovered in weird places all the time, and then being restored in some way.
Oh, that's fantastic.
Yeah, usually it involves, because celluloid stock is notoriously flammable and volatile, and it also has a tendency to dissolve over time.
Yeah.
If it doesn't catch fire,
so
you have to transfer it to acetate film.
Mm.
And from there to digitize it and restore it and clean it up as best you can.
Yeah.
But that gives you an idea of why I find this subject so fascinating. And I was thrilled to be able to do it for you.
Thank you so much. That was a wonderful exploration of silent film. And it just blows my mind how far we've come in 100 years.
Yes. Uh-huh.
Yeah. Thank you so much for the whole presentation. That was fantastic.
Yeah, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Are there any closing thoughts that you would like to end with?
Yeah. Well, I guess just occasionally somebody loves this form so much that they try to resurrect it every now and then. A few years ago, a film called The Artist, a French film, was done as a silent movie.
I remember seeing that. Yeah.
And it too was set in the closing days of silent film.
Yeah.
And the transition to talkies. So it's almost a sister film to Singing in the Rain.
Yeah. Well, it sounds like an homage of sorts, which is lovely.
Yeah. It is an homage. And also Hugo, Martin Scorsese's Hugo, which is one of the only family-friendly films he ever made, because he usually goes for the gangsters. But yeah. Hugo is set in the 1930s, and the little boy finds Georges Méliès in his dotage.
Oh, wow.
And sort of restores his lost glory to him.
Very cool. Very cool. I want to thank you for being part of this.
And thank you for inviting me.
And for all the hard work you put in, this completely kicked ass.
Thank you. It was, in terms of the technology, I was a little nervous about whether I was going to be able to control it, but yay.
No, you did good.
I figured it
out. We got through it. All right. Well, I really want to thank everybody for watching today. And kittoms.
My little movie star.
But thank you so much, Rosanna. This was completely fantastic. And I want to say thank you to anybody who is viewing today. I appreciate you coming and sharing in this with us.